very important moment to be talking about the U.S. history of drone war. For the first time since we have been doing these panels every year, for quite a number of years, I think since 2009 or 10, when very few people were aware that the U.S. was beginning targeted killing in Pakistan and Yemen. For the very first time, the control of the drone apparatus has passed from Obama, who we fought on this very hard for 8 years over the fact that targeted killing cannot be justified morally or through international law. This is the deliberate targeted killing, and we know quite a lot about the terms on which it was carried out, even though it was a secret program of people based on their profiles, i.e. males in Pakistan of over 18. That was enough to get somebody targeted and killed. And we know that thousands of other people who were not specifically targeted were killed in this 8-year war of terror. It was an aspect of the war of terror that was hidden, secret, and entirely chilling, intimidating, and terrorizing for the people who have lived under it all those years, in at least 7 countries that we could identify. That would be Iraq, Afghanistan, Yemen, Libya, Somalia,
Pakistan,
Syria. And these are countries that, just to be clear, do not have an air force. Do not have air forces.
Pakistan
has an air force. Yemen has an air force. Does Pakistan deploy its air force against other countries? They do not deploy their air force against Afghanistan. They have threatened India. But this has not been a situation where there's any history of these countries killing from the air. So in 2016, control of this vast, unknown arsenal that's highly developed and is further being developed passed to the control of a fascist regime. And I'm not naming only Trump, I'm naming Pence and everyone that they've brought into the Washington establishment to have their fingers on not only the nuclear controls, but on all of this fearsome war material and strategy that was developed since the Bush regime, which was bad enough. Many of us began working intensively, well, I would say in this room, against what the U.S. was doing internationally during the Vietnam War, but then continued it very heavily when the Bush regime attacked Iraq and began this 16-year-old so-called war on terror that we have come to refer to as a war of terror for the people who have been suffering under it. And I want to make very clear that this war on terror is not only not over, but is being threatened in ways that we did not expect Obama to do, for instance. Obama and the Democrats have made a very big deal historically about human rights around the world. They've used that as a bludgeon against other countries when it suited them. And sometimes they actually had fights over human rights. The Trump regime couldn't give a flying you-know-what about human rights or even posing to care about human rights. What did he say on the campaign trail? And this is very relevant to the question of targeting killing in drones. Bomb the hell out of them. Kill them all. Go after their families. They don't care about their own lives. They do care about their families, kill their families. So So this is a situation where we have a real responsibility of facing right up to what's happening and what's going on. And we are, you know, glad today that we're going to be able to hear from several people who, for the time being, are really focusing their life's work on stopping the U.S. drone war, particularly targeted killing in conjunction with stopping the war on terror. And there's really a lot to learn from them, both about the struggle that's going on, how people are approaching it, and what this represents. So I want to say to people who are watching on video that World Can't Wait makes these materials available on our website, and we link to the websites and the material that the presenters have prepared. And this is all available for you to make use of wherever you are in the world. And I know that a lot of our viewers see this on our Spanish website. In fact, ironically, more people sometimes read our material on our Spanish site and on our English-speaking site. But to people all over the world, we're here because we care about humanity and the planet, and we want to stop the crimes of our own government, including putting our own lives on the line around us. I'm Deborah Sweet. I'm the director of World Can't Wait, and I'm very glad to welcome two of our three panelists. The other one will come in here in a minute. The panelists we have to present to you today are Elsa Rosbach, who's a resident of Germany and is very involved not only with the history of the anti-war movement in the U.S. and Germany, but now currently in stopping the collaboration between the U.S. and the German governments, and now the Israeli government, in bringing killer armed drones into Germany. We're going to hear more about that project. And also, on my right, your left, is Ed Canaan, who we heard yesterday was in Iraq for 5 months during shock and awe when the Bush regime unleashed the terror in 2003 of bombing and occupation of Iraq. Here's somebody who has a great deal of experience and knows what he's talking about and is now a very active participant and leader in upstate drone action up in Syracuse, New York, where Hancock Air Force Base is the site of the MQ-9 Reaper drones that are active over Afghanistan and probably possibly other places. Part of uncovering and stopping the secret U.S. drone war is having people who spend time being at those sites and exposing those sites. So we are very fortunate to have them here to be able to share with us what they're working on. And after they present substantively, then we're going to have some discussion about carrying this struggle forward. So I'd like to turn it over to Elsa first, who's going to be able to show us a presentation that she makes in at least several countries to a lot of different groups about this urgent matter of the U.S. using NATO forces to deploy killer drones around the world.
So, I give presentations mainly in Germany, and they go from, some of them are an hour long, so this is a very reduced version. But the reason I had wanted to spin, and just a little bit about me, I grew up in Colorado, and I went to college in the U.S., and I went to grad school in Germany. I was involved in the struggle with GIs. There were two big bases in Berlin, and working with them. And then I was here for about 25 years, and worked in public television, and tried to do ANOVA initially when that started, and also then to do labor history projects. And then when I went back to Germany on a small job, I wound up staying, and I got really re-involved in the peace movement. It's pretty much almost my full-time work, although I try to do film and journalism and so, since the Iraq War began in 2003. You know, so, and I would have wanted to spin off of you, Ed, because my talk is going to be about the German movement against drone warfare. And it's not only, it's the fundamental one initially was that Germany should not have armed drones. And then only later did we discover that, because it was held secret, that the U.S. bases in Germany were being used and played an essential war in the U.S. drone warfare. So that became a second branch of our struggle, a very important one. And the entire reason that there is any drone campaign in Germany, which has been the most significant in Europe, is because of the awareness of the drone movement in the U.S. of the things like that you, Ed, are doing, that others are doing, all they did leak through the struggles at the bases, of course, the spectacular things of Medea interrupting Obama, the court cases, and so forth, that all penetrated. So, but as a background, it penetrated in a country that really changed significantly, not immediately after World War II, but became, in its majority, a deeply pacifist country. The majority of people, I want to know how deeply, we're worried that it will change at this point. So the basic feeling was pacifist, and you even find the New York Times complaining about the German pacifists and they won't go to war with NATO and so forth. So there became, there was a saying, never again. And also there was, as with Japan, there was in the German Constitution that it's against the German Constitution to start any war from German soil. So when German NATO, when Joshua Fischer betrayed the Green Party principles and went into, I'm talking to all these things, went into Yugoslavia, that was the first break with that tradition. And ever since, they've been Germans, ruling elites have been trying to get Germany to militarize more and more. This is all in the context of Germany still today being the most, having the most U.S. bases of any country in the world, and also having the most U.S. troops of any European country by far, ranging between 30 and 60,000, depending on what's happening, whereas other countries like Italy or other and so forth might have 3 or 4,000. And so that's just as a background. While wanting to be pacifist, they're also heavily, some would say, occupied by the U.S. military. That was surely the case until 1991 when they achieved, when they were unified and achieved sovereignty. We would argue that they have full sovereignty and it's Germany's responsibility to adhere to German law, and when the U.S. does not do so, to do something about it and to adhere to the German Constitution. Okay, so it's not so easy now. Let's see if I know how to do this. Yes. Another thing is, besides having the most bases and the most significant, technologically significant bases in Europe, which include especially Ramstein, the Pentagon has divided up the world initially into five regions of military combat and surveillance. Initially, AFRICOM was part of OICOM. OICOM is European Command. We see that it stretches to the former Soviet Union, through to Greenland, to Alaska, and up to Greenland. And in 2008, without discussing this, and this was always based in Stuttgart. It's also part of the Cold War thing. The headquarters of USICOM was in Stuttgart. All the others were in the U.S. CENTCOM is in Florida, for example, I believe. And then they decided, in 2008, in a secret agreement, they decided to create AFRICOM because Bush wanted to go big time into more and more military ventures in AFRICOM. And they tried to get different African countries to take it. I understand they're close to 20, and none would, and so they let it be in Stuttgart. So you could say a third of the U.S. central commands are in Germany. And we recently had Trump say that he's giving the military free hand, that he didn't personally decide about the big bomb. And there's other indications that some of the military decisions and crimes are being made right on German soil and not necessarily being ratified even in Washington, which was always what was said before. Okay. So these are all the places as of 2005 where there have been no drone strikes. There probably were others in other places like Mali. There's reports in the Philippines, but these are the major ones. Syria's not yet on this map. So Germans were very aware of that, and Germans always believed after World War II, they took the Nuremberg principles seriously, they take the UN seriously, they saw the adherence to international law as key also to their own security. So they were very disturbed about all of the strikes that were not in Afghanistan. Afghanistan, they would say, was a legalized by the UN war, you know, and so they're less concerned, even though, of course, the victims experienced it in much the same way. But I'm talking about how they would review it. So this was all in discussion. And in 2012, then the German defense minister came to the press and said, I want to have armed drones within the next few months. So there was huge outrage, even in some leading press, the Süddeutsche, which is like our New York Times. And we started, and they were trying to sell it in Europe. They tried to sell it as, you know, very humanitarian aid mixed with war. This is a NATO advertisement, what the drones are. You have a little war on terror, you have a little traffic control, you have a little humanitarian aid, and you can see all the things that they're saying that these drones are good for. So it's part of the a lot of the development in Europe, because they don't want military drones, but they're actually developing military drones for things like border control, but they will later could be used for military, and that they're concerned about killing in an illegal way, okay? What is generally recognized by attorneys. So in March 2013, actually this started to be discussed in the German peace movement at the time when Code Pink was in Pakistan. This was even reported in the German news. If I would mention to German politicians, not necessarily even on the left party, oh, I'm with Code Pink, they say, oh, thank you for letting us know about this drone war and what all the problems with it. That was at that time. So I'm saying this to you because however much you feel you're not heard, you're being heard internationally, maybe more than you sometimes are in the U.S., and it's having an impact. So we formed with 100 organizations, came and met in March in 2013, and did this statement, and it basically, you could probably all read it there, or I should get my glasses and read it to you. Should I read it aloud, or I have it printed out, but the basic things are all the things that they were saying about what the U.S. drone thing movement is. It entails targeted killing of people within and outside war areas without indictment, trial, and conviction, terrorize the population of the targeted territory by threatening life and limb, encourages the development of autonomous killer robots, thereby making more horrifying wars likely, initiates a new round in the arms race, and we demand that the German government and parliament cease the madness of production and acquisition of armed drones, as well as their research and development, and become engaged in favor of a worldwide ban and international proscription of these weapons. Now, at that time, only the U.S., Israel, and Great Britain Afghanistan, the U.S. had, as far as we know, even used targeted drones for killing. So this was signed, you know, not only by a bunch of peace activists. It was signed not only by, leading other, which we say not necessarily peace groups, but it was also signed by the entire left parliamentary group and the entire Green parliamentary group, and many significant members of the Social Democratic Party. And so that the Greens and the left together have about 20% in the parliament. This would be like if you had Jill Stein with 20% fraction, if you could have that in Congress, if you can imagine. So she might not get anything through, but she could certainly talk a lot about it. So we began protesting. This is a civil disobedience action that I was involved in right in the German parliament. Our main issue at that time was not U.S. drones. Our main issue is we don't want Germany to do what the U.S. is doing. So we're in there where they're talking about these drones, and this is in April 2013. And let's put it this way. this way, you're having a hearing to get the, acquire the armed drones and form this one in with red hands and really copying code pink and so forth to protest this. Okay, that's all, and you don't have to really see this protest. So now, we also have then an international global action day with over 60 participants worldwide that we organized a lot from Germany. Medea Benjamin had come over, her book, Drone Warfare, was published in German in 2013. We had a meeting, international meeting, in the December 2013, and one of the results was this Global Action Day in October 2014. And again, it's against the weapon here. It's not against the use of the weapon of the U.S., but it's against the weapon itself. And Nick Modern was, we worked very closely together on this. Okay, so now, now, what started to open up the use of the U.S. were two things. Faisal Ali bin Jaber of Yemen, who's been also in the U.S. Congress, he filed a lawsuit in Germany about his relatives being killed and said that German government helped the U.S. Kill his family by allowing Ramstein to be used. And this court case was actually accepted into the German courts. It's still running. This is, I believe, the only court system that has accepted a drone victim that was not a citizen, that the injury was another part of the world, because under the German Constitution after World War II, and if anyone is injured by the German government in any way, wherever they are, they can sue the German government. Okay. Germany in 2013, and in 2015 he testified for about 5 hours in the German parliament, which is also the only parliament in the world that is investigating U.S. drone strikes from, and they're doing it with regard to Ramstein, but they probably aren't going to actually do anything about it so far. So, okay. So what he told us was that, you know, there is a distributed ground network, many of you know that, that where they collect from the whole world, the U.S., all the video images and all for doing the targeting, and that the only, besides the three in the U.S., including Langley, the CIA, Beale, and Hawaii, is in Ramstein and in Korea, in South Korea. Okay, next slide. And then the Snowden documents came out, and one of them that was published in The Intercept in 2015 showed that all of the U.S., all of the U.S. bases, like Hancock and so forth, like you see New York down here, you see from all around the U.S., they're all feeding all their signals into Creech Air Base in Nevada. That's being transferred by a cable to Ramstein Air Base, and from there to a satellite that and the satellite signal directs the drones that are stationed, for example, for Pakistan in Afghanistan or for Yemen in East Africa, etc. Okay. And here's another drawing that makes it even clearer. That was in the same Intercept article. You can see how this supposedly works has been visualized. With you see where Creech is and the undersea carrier cable and then Ramstein. This is not so easily replaceable, incidentally. Okay. Then so it has developed finally, and this was a very big thing because for Germans to demonstrate against the U.S. bases, they rose being accused of being really bad communists or Nazis. I mean, to get Germans to demonstrate against a big U.S. base is huge. So our first demonstration at Ramstein, big base, you know, there have been a few against nuclear weapons in 2004 and all, but this was the first big one since. This had several hundred. I'm proud that I was right in the front row there, and I helped get this started in Germany. The connection with the U.S. helped, and they also are more able to protest if a U.S. person says it's okay, we're against it too. They feel less like we're, you know, the Germans and we should not speak up. We're the guilty ones. So that was several hundred. Now the next one in 2016, that was 5,000, which is pretty unheard of. And now we have another one coming up in September this year, 2017. Maybe it will be larger. And I spoke at these first two ones. Now Anne Wright is coming to speak. And I encourage anyone who has the time to come over. There'll be a camp, and it will be a lot of fun. And there will be many people who speak English. Don't worry about that. And it's very, very significant, I think, that this is happening. Okay, next. Then what about AFRICOM? We also protest against AFRICOM. I was involved in a lawsuit actually suing a GI, an MP who put handcuffs on me at a protest with Code Pink here. And I won the case against me and got great press, positive press in Stuttgart because so many of the German people are against what the US is doing. But this is what AFRICOM does. It's in charge of everything, just like CENTCOM is for Afghanistan or Iraq. It's in charge of everything that's done in Africa, special forces, supposed humanitarian aid, but also everything having to do with drones, which has greatly expanded since 2008, and all their missions have. So you see on the left this, the countries, although there's probably more now, where US drone strikes have taken place, and then on the right, the US bases in Africa that have been developed really out of Stuttgart, okay? So, and then the last slide. So this was part of the blockade we did. I believe that we've had in Germany the most extended discussion to try to prevent getting any weaponizable or weaponized drones. The biggest demonstrations against a U.S. drone base at Ramstein, except in Pakistan maybe, but they weren't at the base. And now the biggest blockade was done by musicians. All four gates of AFRICOM blockaded for 4 hours with the traffic jam, 7 hours going into downtown Stuttgart and getting great press in prime time TV and whatever, and that shows how whatever this, how significant this is. How significant the German opposition is. But we still haven't got the Germany was saying up until it was hedging for like 3 years after Brandon Bryan came and so forth, said, well, we don't really know what the U.S. is doing and so forth. They finally admitted December 1st last year that the U.S. is doing this, that the U.S. government had told them in August of 2016 that it does play a central role. So they admitted this to the German parliament on the question of one of the left party candidates. And so, but there hasn't been any movement on this with regard to Ramstein. Or do some people want to close the base. Anne Ryan would say close the base. But I know, I always was saying close the base since 2006. I did demos there and different people. But realistically, we could win possibly on the international law issue with regard to the drone strikes. And not saying it is realistic, but it's the most realistic that we could do. And one reason is that this belief that international law should not be violated is very, very important in where did I put this?
Thank you.
I just want to, I'm going to pass this out. A European Parliament resolution of February 2014, and the European Parliament unfortunately doesn't have teeth, it's advisory. It basically calls on the High Representative for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy in the member states to oppose and ban the practice of extrajudicial targeted killings, to ensure that the member states, in conformity with their legal obligations, do not perpetrate unlawful targeted killings or facilitate such killings by other states, include armed drones in relevant European and international disarmament and arms control regimes, ban the development, production, and use of fully autonomous weapons, which enable strikes to be carried out without human intervention, commit to ensuring that where there are reasonable grounds for believing that an individual or entity within their jurisdiction may be connected to an unlawful targeted killing abroad, measures are taken in accordance with their domestic and international legal obligations, which in Germany would be to arrest also US troops, not just German troops, or civilian actors, CIA, contractors, and so forth, if they really did this. And support the work and follow up the recommendations of the UN. So I brought this with you. That's the hope that's in Europe. The negative part is the arms manufacturers there. They are, and now Trump also. The arms manufacturers are driving that Europe should have its own weapon, competitive world drone. They want to compete with Israel and the US on the world drone arms market. And unfortunately, China and Russia, who have not, as we know, have used armed drones, they're jumping in. Lots of countries and arms things are now jumping in. The moment when we were back in 2013 and calling for them to ban was much more hopeful than it is now, unfortunately. And so, as a result, we now have a very important struggle in Germany. We have the Ramstein, we have AFRICOM, but we have a struggle to stop the German government from acquiring now an armable drone from Israel. And the reason they want Israel is this. The U.S. has not been willing to share its technology. They have sold the Reapers and Predators in 2007 to Great Britain, and they even required from 2007 to 2013 that the British pilots sit in Creech next to the U.S. pilots in order, you know, and could not direct these drones from England. There were big protests, though, when they said, started saying they could direct them from Waddington. Okay, the next ones that got one was Italy, 2012, armable, weaponizable. The U.S. Congress held them up. I think they might have gotten them weaponized this year. They've been seeking weapons for 5 years. U.S. turned down Turkey and said you can't have weapons, you know, mentioned human rights violations. U.S. gave weaponizable drones to France and Holland, but they don't have them yet. Israel will play ball with Germany. Israel will help share, will share more of its technology, will share its know-how. And you know what? The German pilots are going to get to sit right in Israel on an IDF airbase and be trained there and do their killing from Israel. Do their killing right now, they would say, just in Afghanistan, a legal war, and in Mali, in partnership with the French. So, and not only that, the, you know, Germany has always said that because of our guilt with the Holocaust and so forth, I'm saying, I'm half German, originally my father was, that you know, we have a special relationship with Israel. And this means, of course, it's even harder for Germans even to protest. Some of you might have heard how Germans are afraid of being called anti-Semitic. It'll be a little harder to protest. There's quite a lot of anti-American feeling in this being even, you heard what Merkel said about Trump even recently. It's going further. They want independence somehow from the U.S. They're scared to death of the U.S. And another thing driving the arms race in Europe on many fronts, some talking about European nuclear weapons, more modernization, is their fear of the Americans. You know, what are they going to do? They basically have the bases in their country. But the Americans are turning into fascists. You know, the Americans have the NSA. Americans are doing all sorts of things that Germany said, we threw that all off. We never wanted to do that again. And this is really bad. So they're feeling, well, we have to compete, the weapons manufacturers, but maybe even militarily. In the drone warfare, in my opinion, they will only be able to compete on the world weapons markets. Germans are great on that, and the Nazis were 25 years ahead of anyone else in 45 on television, being using television technology to guide unmanned missiles, you know, the B-2 and all that. And it was, all that technology was snapped up by the U.S., and you might recall how Werner von Braun was a big hero. Some of us were old enough in the 50s, the Nazi developer of the B-2. So, but the thing is that we have to stop this, and we're going to, I'm just saying that we want to, I'm at the end, that we feel, with regard to Ramstein discussion, there was a letter, I think you signed it, right, and you definitely signed it and worked on it with me, and I think you definitely signed it too, that was addressed to Chancellor Merkel, saying, do something about Ramstein. This was in May 2015, before the Ramstein campaign was even founded. It helped enable the Ramstein campaign be founded. And I would like now that we do another letter from the U.S. peace movement to the Social Democratic Party saying, do not vote for these drones, because this is being rushed on us. We all thought it was happening in the fall. Everyone was saying that. Now we have to do everything we can by June 21st to stop this, if you read the article. And the reason I say the Social Democrats, I don't love the Social Democrats. But the Greens and the left are already committed against it. We don't have to spend time on them. The CDU is already committed for it. The SPD has this ambivalent tradition, going for Willy Brandt, breaking with the U.S. somewhat on Cold War, Schroeder, you know, not sending troops but still allowing the U.S. to use the bases. Even Steinmeier, the minister doing the foreign affairs in English and in the New York Times, saying don't rattle sabers on the Russian border. So that's a project we're going to discuss after this, but because we have to act fast and try to, if we want to do it, if people think it's a good idea, we'll do it in the next week. So
we'll have a discussion. Thank you. Let's make it clear that it was the fault of the Israel parade creating a horrendous traffic.
I can testify to that.
Yes. I want to introduce Nick Modern, who is a journalist and an activist for quite a long time on many different issues relating to peace and human rights. But for the last almost 10 years, he's been working on the issue of targeted and is the webmaster and organizer of nodrones.com.
So I'm happy to be here. I thought the subject matter for this today, and I'm going to read this because I want to be fairly precise. But the title of my talk is Race Rationalizes Murder. And the question in the announcement of the panel today is, how do we build a movement of massive and resolute opposition to wars of empire? And we can see in our turnout today that evidently the issues of war and wars of empire are not high priority for many people attending the left forum. And so my response to this question of how we build a movement is, this is sort of an experimental talk, and so I'll probably make some assertions here, some of which I'm not altogether certain about, but I thought it would be something that we could talk about. My response to building a movement has to do with race. And I want to say up front that I don't mean to be self-righteous and I don't mean to be abrasive. I simply want to say that I believe that at this moment it is imperative that we ask, how does racism within the white American left prevent building a movement within the left to stop the current American war? The manifestation of racism that I'm talking about is the very widespread acceptance of the murder of people of color, both inside and outside the United States. This acceptance takes its form in many ways. One is the failure of the left to collectively give top priority to organizing massive, sustained marches and civil disruption calling for, one, police review boards and accountability for the justice system in the United States, and two, ending the military intervention of all kinds overseas. And of course, this is primarily in poorer countries occupied by what we would define here as people of color. At this moment, one must ask, if racism is not at work in the white American left, how do we explain the fact that the fish-in-the-barrel slaughter of thousands of people by U.S. drones and a massive U.S. bombing campaign across the Middle East, how is it that this does not rank number one on the action agenda of the American left? What is it within the American left that has so far prevented the organizing of a drumbeat of protest against an attack against North Korea? An attack that will likely involve nuclear weapons, but will certainly involve the killing of tens of thousands of people, even if conventional weapons are used. How is it that the top priority of the American left is anything but the stopping of the current planned wholesale slaughter of human beings, particularly human beings who are defined as threats by the very government that the American left calls out as corporate control and bent on building empire? Are not the people being killed overseas at this moment in some way in the same category as native people on this continent who were slaughtered by Europeans who discovered America? All Europeans who landed in the New World did not actively kill native people, but most Europeans did not act to stop the killing, because they had been convinced by their leaders that, as the Declaration of Independence says, they were confronted by merciless Indian savages whose known rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. That still exists in our Declaration of Independence. I am among those who have been too accepting of U.S. killing, and I believe that my patience, my willingness to look toward long-term education to stop wars, or to demand a stop to police killing, to fail to demand psychological reviews from police in my community and other communities, or the failure to not demand legal review of every single case of an incarcerated person in the United States. This patience and this acceptance, I believe, is related to my being white and being privileged because I'm white. In this struggle that we are in to stop killing, a struggle that requires mass organization, we must, I believe, examine everything, and that means examining racism, white supremacy, and all the notions, feelings, fears, and behaviors around race, because race has so much to do with the killing, especially in Trump's world. I want to just close with a story that is somewhat appropriate to this. As you know, we've been doing No Drones advertisements against drone warfare that run in Syracuse, that run in Niagara Falls, out in Las Vegas, other places where there are drone control centers. And we're working on an ad right now that will have a video, I think, of Eric Garner being essentially strangled by police in Brooklyn, and then followed by a clip of someone being killed by a drone. I think it's going to be in Pakistan. And I drafted a small script for this, and I sent it to James Ricks. Many of you know James as a black, consistent, and highly, I'd say, ethical person who's been arrested a number of times protesting drones in Syracuse. And I asked him, what did he think about the ad? And he said, well, what you have for your message, which was U.S. drones kill people of color without due process, he said, it sounds like a very white way of saying this. He said, let me think about it. And so he talked with some of his friends, and he said two things. First of all, that I think a better message would be race rationalizes murder. And he said that the picture of the video we were going to use, which was Walter Scott being murdered by a policeman, he said that's one of the few cases where a cop was ever brought to justice. So it would be better to use.
Well, not yet. Not yet.
Well, let's just say.
He got a mistrial. He hasn't been brought to justice, but at least he was charged.
Where it stands, it's a lot closer than most places.
Yeah.
And so he suggested we use a different video clip. And so what I felt, in speaking with him about this, and I should also say, and I'm sure you're aware that there was a trial up in Syracuse. He was one of the defendants. And the jury remarkably basically went against the judge and the attorney, the district attorney, and found all the people innocent. Now, that trial was actually postponed because the first trial had no black people in the jury pool. Second trial did, but the woman, I can't remember exactly the reason, someone here could probably explain that. But at one point, James told me she made a remark to the judge, I can't find these people guilty, And so we don't, ever know what the mix is, what the judge's brain and other people. But I have to think that just that whole postponement and then, the involvement of this woman had maybe a positive effect. And so I guess I'm saying it's not just that we need to involve more black people in the peace movement. I think everybody knows that. But it has to do with how willing are we to learn from black people or other people from other countries about what we're doing, and do we and will we call out our white colleagues about the issue of race? Because clearly that's the underpinning of this assault. There's a quote from James Baldwin. It was in this movie, I don't know if you've seen it, I Am Not Your Negro. But it says, what white people have to do is try to find out in their hearts why it was necessary for them to have a N-word in the first place. Because I am not a N-word. I am a man, and I am not the N-word here. And if you invented him, you, the white people, invented him, then you have to find out why. And the future of the country depends on that. Whether or not the country is able to ask that question. Now, there's another thing I wanted to read to finish up. There's a book that I read about, I have a review here. It says, Why I Am No Longer Talking About Race, and this is by a black woman. And there's a quote from the book. It says, racism is a white problem. It reveals the anxieties, hypocrisies, and double standards of whiteness as a problem in the psyche of whiteness that white people must take responsibility to solve. You can only do so much from the outside. And I know for me personally, I have always had the idea that racism was best attacked and assaulted by black people. And that would be the way this would, as we saw in the civil rights movement, this was something that would move under the impetus of black people. But we also, you know, based on this kind of commentary, we have to ask ourselves, is that sufficient, given the way race is the underpinning of wholesale slaughter around the world? And if we relate it to global warming, we have to say that race is the underpinning of the assault on various countries to mine their oil, their gas, their minerals, and burn them at will. And so I'm just offering this up as something that, you know, we might want to discuss and to say, how do we approach this? I'm not quite sure, but I do believe we must call out the people on our colleagues who are interested in global warming and who interested in, you know, single-payer health care, interested in other things that seem to be much higher on the agenda, and not put up with what we see happening right now. So, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
So our third and last presenter is Ed Mann from Upstate Grown Action, which is, I won't say he's, I'm not limiting to him to speaking just about drones, but the topic of the, what we're getting into today is the Trump style of going after the war on the world. And we know that it is very wrapped up with targeted killing, but there's also other aspects of that, and I think it would be good to get into the discussion later with some of the things that Nick raised. What I believe Ed has prepared is a very specific look that we get in the campaign to stop the targeted killing coming out of Hancock Air Force Base in Syracuse, both what they've done and what they aspire to do. And I think it's really important to have from the horse's mouth, as it were, this is what we're grappling with, and this is how we're going at it. So I look forward to hearing and seeing the evidence of this five-year-long campaign now.
Eight,
of course, when the drone started.
Well, it started
2009. The drone started earlier than that, but
yeah.
Obama came in and began the wholesale use of targeted killing in 2009.
Okay, thank you. Get out of sight of people here. Well, first of all, my name is Ed Kanan. I'm from Syracuse, New York. I'm involved in Upstate Drone Action, which was founded back in 2010. And with me today is my partner, Ann Tiffany, who was also very much a part of the origins of Upstate Drone Action, as well as two close friends who are stalwarts in Upstate Drone Action, Bev Rice from Manhattan and Joan Plume from Brooklyn. We are, the four of us are part of this group, Upstate Drone Action. and our focus has been on direct action. Nonviolent, colorful, creative, and persistent direct action right at the main gate of Hancock Air Force Base. And the reason we focus on Hancock, well, one thing, Ann and I live right in Syracuse, which used to be within walking distance of me. I no longer walk that far, but it didn't move. I've changed. So I don't have any AV, I don't have an AV bone in my body. So, but I do have, Ann was offered to hold up some of the glimpses we have of our Hancock actions, which have been going on since about 2010, since 2010. Two or three times a year, we go right to the, right outside the base's main gate, we do these direct actions. And I don't know if you could read the text. This is our friend Julianne, who is also with us from the beginning as well. It says, "We still will not be complicit with our government's war crimes." Now, those of us in upstate direct action, and a lot of us have been at it all these years, have been influenced by the Nuremberg Principles, which came to pass right after World War II, and which came out of that was the idea is that citizens are complicit in their government's actions. If they know their government is committing war crimes, we as citizens have a responsibility to out those war crimes, to expose them. And that's really the main thrust of our campaign. Let's have another one on, This isn't, actually, this isn't one of our direct actions that led to arrest. This is what we call street heat. Each week, we are, twice a month, we are the first and third Tuesdays of the month, we are out at Hancock. We're across the road from Hancock, so we're not at risk of arrest. But we call it street heat. And then the other Tuesdays of the month, we're at other kind of very busy intersections around Syracuse and Onondaga County with our signage to expose the war crimes that are beginning, that are happening at Hancock Air Base. Now, the thing about Hancock is it's the host of the 174th Attack Wing. This is how it calls itself, Attack Wing, of the New York National Guard. Now, they're very proud of this term, Attack Wing. You know, they brought it out, they rolled it out, you know, with a press conference. People don't seem to bat an eyelash. But supposing instead of Attack Wing, it said Rape Wing, maybe there'd be some eyelashes raised. But in this society, at this time, this economy, this culture, under this very militaristic and corrupt two-party system, Attack Wing gets a pass. So our job of State Joint Action is to try to wake up the public to what's going on at Hancock, and to wake up the personnel on the base. There's several hundred personnel on the base. We stand outside the base twice a month doing street heat. As the traffic comes off the base, the change of shift in the afternoon. And that personnel coming off the base have to see our signs. And they say things like, you know, drones fly, children die, that kind of thing. Now, one of our actions at the base was drones kill children. And you can see these banners, and they're right at the main entrance of the base. And what we do is we block the entrance. That doesn't keep vehicles from going in. They can go in through other more obscure gates, but it does kind of make a statement not only to the passerbys, of which there are a lot. I mean, it's on East Malloy Road, in the town of DeWitt, in the county of Onondaga, and this is a very busy road. So we reach hundreds and hundreds of drivers and passerbys in this technique that, you know, doesn't have a lot of rivals. I mean, there's other media out there, and the public, I think, this is kind of novel to a lot of the public, so maybe it kind of gets in under the radar. So we focus on not only children, but on the innocents in general. In my mind, virtually everyone is an innocent, man, woman, child, but a lot of children and a lot of women get killed, as well as males who may or may not be militants or may or may not be fighting against the imperial invasion of their country. But to me, it's a dastardly, cowardly way of making your point to kill. Some of you may have seen this image before. This is an image which appeared in a field in Waziristan, which is the northwest part of Pakistan, which has suffered severely from the drones. In this image, I've seen photos of it in the field, is probably about the size of this room. So the idea is that the drone pilots, drone operators, can see this image if they're looking. So there's so many ways to go with this, and I don't have a prepared presentation. I haven't made this presentation about the history of our campaign. What I've done mostly in my talks has been to talk about drones, you know, the reasons why we oppose drones, the connection between drones and terrorism and imperialism. So I'm kind of winging it here, but here's another one of our demonstrations. The text says, the Jerry Berrigan Memorial Drone Blockade. From the very beginning in 2010, Jerry Berrigan, in a wheelchair, approaching his 90s back then, well, this was age, 19 or 29 life-size. 29 life-size images of Jerry. Did you have a question?
No, I'm sorry. Okay. No.
Some of you may know the Berrigan name. His brothers, Dan and Phil, were famous war resistors, now both deceased. And Jerry was also a resistor within Syracuse. He's a family man, adopted several children. So beloved by the community. Now, I think on the back of that photo is another one. Here I am being arrested out of Hancock. You'll notice there's quite a few cops. They've been very much into overkill in arresting us. There's not only the DeWitt Town Police, there's the Onondaga County Sheriff's, there's the New York State Troopers that converge and take us away. They give us a warning saying that, you know, if you don't leave, you're going to be arrested. So we don't leave, and we're arrested. And after we're arrested, there's this whole process of being booked, fingerprinted, photographed. So this is the booking. Then we go to an arraignment, and we get a court date, multiple court dates, because they have to jump through all these hoops. We go to court, and our court turns out in various ways. Sometimes we're found innocent. Sometimes there's a jury, sometimes it's a judge trial. Sometimes we're found guilty, and we're fined, and a number of us go to jail with a certain frequency. And if we have time for some Q&A, we could talk more about the different aspects of what I call arrest witness and trial witness and prison witness. These, to me, are important moments in our resistance. And if you read the Left Forum publicity, that's the theme. of this left forum. So that's why we're, we wanted to bring to the left forum our resistance, which we think of as creative, we think of it as persistent, for one thing. We keep going there. And myself, before I got involved with the drones at Hancock, I was quite involved, in, as was Ann, in the School of the Americas campaign to close the School of the Americas down for
that's where I got this thing.
Is that your t-shirt?
My t-shirt.
Yeah. Well, that taught me lessons about persistence, about nonviolence, about creative. What we did with our big books action was we picked four books that we wanted the world to know about. And we used those to block the entrance to the base. The Charter of the United Nations, Living Under Drones, which is a very important text for understanding what it's like to live in areas where drones are marauding and preying. Jeremy Scahill's Dirty Wars, really powerful book. And what was the book? Oh, The Reprieve Report. The Reprieve Report is it's a British human rights organization that studied the attacks, the drone attacks, and found out that, you know, they were targeted at a particular terrorist. I always put that word in quotations. There's a real lots of problems with defining that word. And they found that for every so-called terrorist that was targeted and killed, like 9 civilians were also killed. 9 others, usually unknown people, what the military blandly calls collateral damage.
Actually, the Reprieve said 28, right?
Hmm?
28. Yeah, the Reprieve study says was in Pakistan and Yemen and said actually 28
unknowns.
No, and then the other one, though, I'm not criticizing, I'm just saying that drone paper is the one that came out later, so
I tend not to use statistics much. You know, I don't trust them much, so I could be a little, you know, fuzzy in the edges.
We just decided on
this. Now, where was I here? But one of the interesting things about the Reprieve Report was that it followed up on targeting of these particular terrorists. Well, in many cases, the terrorist wasn't killed. The so-called terrorist wasn't killed. In fact, the so-called terrorist would re-emerge later. And so they targeted him again. And that's part of the reason why there would be even more killings. That it didn't work too well in the first place. And it was surrounded by a lot of lies, a lot of propaganda, a lot of glorification. Wow, we got that terrorist. It's false. So much of it is false. Let's go with the next one. This is our most recent action at Hancock, at the main gate. This is was on Good Friday in the Christian tradition, which is when Jesus was said to have been crucified. And here we have some of our drone people being crucified. And if you look closely, you'll see they're being crucified on drones, on a Reaper drone model. And besides these three, here begins a line of 10 smaller drones going over here, each with a slogan about drones kill, and then there's a word like love, families, and so forth, all 10. So that got quite a bit of play, the imagery, at least in the movement literature, press. And the idea, the connection here, besides the crucifixion and the drones, is that the drones are parallel to the crosses used by the Roman Empire 2,000 years ago. You know, they would line old roadways with crosses, in many cases, the Jewish people or whoever that was perceived as a risk to the empire would be put up on the crosses as a way to terrorize the people. Well, these drones are so instrumental in spreading terror. That war on terror is a war of terror. And drones are a key player in that realm of terror. I can't emphasize too much the importance of this study, Living Under Drones. It's by Stanford Law School and NYU Law School, and they went over to Pakistan, to Waziristan, and interviewed survivors of the drone attacks and made their report.
But that's about 4 or 5 years old now.
Yeah, it was September 2012 is when it came out. But the story that it reports, it is, you know, the human interest stories, but it's very well documented by legal minds and clearly written. And you can download it for free. What we did up at Syracuse was we had our printer, a printer friend, download it, copy it, print it out, and bind it in this cover. And then we've sent dozens and dozens of these around, like the press, the politicians, and, you know, when I give talks, you know, I sometimes have a few copies, which I sell for cost. I don't get it today, but often I do. Of course.
We put the emphasis on these images that we have used in trying to educate people about growth, because that's what the press responds to. When we go out and simply block the entrance or the exit, you don't get the kind of response that a dramatic presentation gives. So I think we have an artist that helps us. And I think you might mention our Christmas.
Our other reaction. How am I doing on time here?
Well, we should finish up so we have
one
some
more.
Okay. So we've had maybe 12, 13 actions since 2010, dramatic, colorful. But so we had this one on Good Friday. The one just before that was on December 23rd. It was a nativity tableau, which we had Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, and the wise men blocking the entrance to the base. And that was pretty colorful, too. It said there was, like, across the top of it was this legend, if Herod had drones, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph would have been incinerated.
Mm-mm.
So, I think I'm about to wrap up here. Looking forward to discussion, questions. So, thank you very much. Thank you, Ann.
I assume that the town you're living in, you're pretty much surrounded by neighbors who are in some way employed by the military. Can I ask you to describe the positive reactions you've had from your community? Because I assume they're all the passers-by, right, on the main road?
I'm very disappointed in Syracuse folks. Many of the folks in Upstate Drone Action that get arrested, often get arrested multiple times, seem to come from outside of Syracuse area. Joan and Bev and others in the New York City area, Buffalo, Albany, Rochester, Binghamton, and Ithaca. Ithaca's been very important in our campaign. And it's Ithaca that comes up with, you know, these props and some of the ideas for them. And the media, I think, doesn't want to go near us. And it's ironic because, you know, I mentioned I work with the School of the Americas Watch campaign to close the School of the Americas at Fort Benning. We got great publicity from local media. You know, a number of us went to prison. There were editorials on our behalf. Like, you know, these are conservative newspapers. And the editorial is like, going to prison for a good cause, that sort of thing. But here's the thing, this is the hometown.
Right.
The hometown doesn't want to publicize resistance, particularly since from Syracuse to Rome, New York, is sort of this the drone development corridor. I mean, it's for commercial drones, and I think Syracuse has the Chamber of Commerce and so forth, and we have this idea the drones are going to be the Silicon Valley, you know, here from Syracuse to Rome.
So they don't want to let the world know that there's really serious questions about the morality of these drones and the legality of these drones. Now, it's further than this, and even more disappointing. Activists in Syracuse tend to compartmentalize. They're very caught up in the Trump thing, you know, local issues, domestic issues, and I think they've made a tactical decision that, well, we just won't bring in international issues. That kind of, you know, muddies the water. So, you know, I'm always running into other activists because we go to lots of different demonstrations locally, you know, and they don't ask about the drone issue. So it's been a real failure locally.
I just want to add that we have lost a lot of manufacturing in upstate New York. It's a real poverty area. Our largest manufacturer is Lockheed Martin. And they haven't left, and they keep growing and getting more and more. They're number one, actually, in terms of weapon production.
Worldwide. So, weapon system production worldwide. Yeah.
So that, I think, is also a big factor.
Joan.
I just wanted to comment something about the job thing in relation to this, the issue of racism. When you stop to think about a situation where you have slaves and you say, well, we have to stop doing this because that's an economic problem for the country, I don't see that there's much difference in that to say we have to keep killing people so that we can have jobs.
Absolutely.
Now, that passes in this country just like that. That's accepted as true. And that very fact, I think, points up the sickness of viewing other people in a certain way that gives you permission to do what you want to them if you can make money at it. And that's the essence of slavery, and that's the essence of these wars.
Elsa wanted to comment.
Well, actually, I want to ask Elsa about a comment first here. I want to just ask a little bit provocatively. I don't think the people of Germany are less racist than the U.S. people. And I think that they are protesting because they feel they have a chance to change something through our very different parliamentary system. I also know that in the area around Ramstein, which has over 50,000 Americans and all the German population in the area is dependent on the U.S. military. They don't want the base to go, but they are in strong disagreement of what they Germans consider illegal drone killings. But Mike, so I think there's other issues here, which has to do with the U.S. generally in all aspects says we could do whatever we want. And this is something that goes back to really World War II and our image. We are the victors. You know, it wasn't until I was 22 or something, and I was in grad school in Germany, that I even learned that over, so many Russians have been killed, you know, and 27, 20 million at that time, I heard, or Soviets, then later it's come up to 27. I don't think most Americans even know the history at all and have any sense that anyone else in the world did anything. But the question I have to you, Ed, is that I have been very troubled about, which was that when Lisa Ling, the drone whistleblower, was recently in Berlin, and she's in the film National Bird, and that's being shown as typical German get in 19 cities and 5 cinemas in Berlin alone and so forth, and they're allowing us to do political work in the cinemas and all. But she said, I've met her, and I said, well, I work with Code Pink, you know, and I've been at Creech and all that. And she was like, I don't want to talk to you. I am against people demonstrating from the bases. If you say children die, drones fly, children die, and things like that, you're making it very difficult for us to bring in other whistleblowers. And she said the whole whistleblower community has agreed on this and so forth. Now, I knew there were these negotiations somehow between the whistleblowers and Code Pink, but of course they would have the same with you all, I imagine, because you're doing going to the base and saying, you know, you guys should feel guilty. This is what we did in the Vietnam War. I think it was very effective. But I just wondered about this issue personally, because I'm in Europe and I don't know what it means, you know, exactly.
Well, I don't think I have a good answer for you, but Lisa has, we've had her at one of our regional meetings, our State Drone Action, by phone, and, you know, she, that is, you understand, that's her perspective. I don't agree with it. I mean, I think it's very important that we try to reach the personnel on the base to let them know. They live in a bubble, and they're brainwashed, they're propagandized. You know, they walked into their, in some cases, you know, they walk into their ergonomically designed trailers where they sit for the screen, and they pass, you know, posters of 9/11. You know, so they get this idea that these people were killing were responsible somehow for 9/11. So I think often their military service is such that they've lived in a bubble for a long time, and they're not in touch with the traditions of, you know, U.S. civil resistance, civil disobedience.
This goes to the difference between the wars and the whole topic we have today. Yesterday at this very table, we had a Vietnam veteran talking about how he went from being a supporter of the war and Republicans to turning against the Vietnam War. And that was on the basis of understanding what damage had been done to the civilian population of Vietnam. But these fighters, these war fighters, are completely divorced from that because of that very remove that you're talking about.
No, I think she's talking about something else, Lisa Lee, because she said she has the whole, they have the whole whistleblower community behind them, and I met Brandon Bryant. I think it may be true that they do. That I think they see it as a tactical issue, that if they're trying to convince others to come on their side within the base, and then there, some of the people in the base are seeing these very disturbing messages. I'm not saying it shouldn't be done. I'm not taking a position on this. That they are saying it's harder to win them over. You know, it's like...
Well,
if you're,
perhaps I could speak to that.
Yeah, yeah, I'm just interested in
hearing
about that. Yeah, with those
negotiating appearances by drone operators at a seminar in Las Vegas in 2016. And also this year, and I know one of them particularly, Sean Westmoreland, has been very concerned about putting, you know, a condemning argument forward to drone operators, shaming them, you know, blaming them. But we had an advertisement that directed to drone operators, and he designed it, that said, can you see reality from a computer screen 10,000 miles away? And, you know, please refuse to fly. He was behind that.
Sean
Westmoreland was supportive of that.
Yeah.
And I understand that he and Brandon Bryant this year went to the encampment of the protesters at Creech.
Okay.
And spoke with them and came to a better understanding of what their purposes are.
So this is still being debated among the whistleblowers.
Well, I think to some degree, and I think Lisa Ling is, in my opinion, is of the few people who are whistleblowers, that she's very much of an outlier on this, and that they're, what I feel is that the drone operators I've encountered are very eager to speak out against that activity, and I think that they have a complaint sometimes with the type of protest. If people are out, you know, dancing around and, you know, holding up dead babies and this kind of thing, they have a problem with that. But I think that most of these other protesters, in my opinion, from talking with them, are consistent with what they support.
She said it was wrong for us to demonstrate.
Well, I'm just saying,
I think that
her view may be
very...
Let's try to bring this to the wider, and I want to call on you, Joan, but the question Carol raised, and Ed and Ann's point about, and your point, Nick, that you challenged us with, how are people seeing these lives that are being taken by what the U.S. is doing in the biggest kind of way? And there is the moral injury point, there is the responsibility of people who are acting directly in the targeted killing, and then there's the responsibility of people who are not acting to stop it. So we do have to think, how are we going to influence millions? Joan?
Oh, I was very intrigued by your saying that race is at the bottom of almost everything. I grew up in a lefty family. go left. And they always said race was at the bottom of the issues in this country. They were very clear on that. Mm-hmm. And of course, there was a tremendous repression of the old left. And so that's not. Andrew Bacevich is a retired colonel or general who's now a professor at Boston University. He has started to write. Each of his book goes deeper. And he's written a lot of different books on the Middle East and on fighting in general. And he's just come out with an article. It's about 10 or 15 pages long. And he lays out the whole American war scenario, all the way from drones to making enormous amounts of money out of war to bases, 100 bases around the world. He lays out the whole war scenario that we're involved in, and our whole culture is permeated by this war culture. So we, with all the goodwill in the world, are working on drones because it's a tremendous moral issue. And it's so obvious and it's so horrible. But I think, I don't have an exact citation, but if you look up under Andrew Bacevich, B-A-C-E-V-I-C-H, his latest article is just fabulous for putting the war system that we have in context, in a much broader context. And I think that's the way we've got to look at it. The other thing is, we've had mass incarceration for years, torturing millions of people by putting them in jail on very crazy, mostly black people. So the racism goes very, very, very deep in this country. And we're not attacking the racism directly, and white people don't seem to know how to do that. And people are frightened. They're frightened for their jobs. They're frightened for their future. And they can't look at that. But there's no question that the racism is at the heart of an awful lot, most of what's happened in this country that's been bad. The racism has prevented white working class people from getting good jobs. The racism has prevented women from being able to be free about taking care of their bodies. The racism has done terrible things in this country, and white working class people or white people have not been able to see what that's all about. So I can understand where you're coming from, but it's difficult because you have to, it's time that we, it's called intersectionality now, that's the big new word. And it's time that we really looked at the whole war thing in this country and the whole racism thing for what it is.
Can I just propose that we think about this in terms of white supremacy? Because that, it's actually a more accurate way of understanding what the dynamic is. And then yes, the racism of white people is a feature of that. But look, none of this is being driven by the racism of white people in the anti-war movement. That is not what is driving the war on the world. It's not what's driving this empire. It's just something that's been created, and yes, we have to combat it. But if we think we're going to stop a patriarchal, fascist, white supremacist regime, if somehow we do the work that makes, you know, each one of us have less overt racism towards other people, I only wish it were that easy. But I'm saying that people are watching on video, and I think, you know, we do have to talk about what's required.
Can I comment on that again? This question to prevent having drones, wanting to maybe prevent the U.S. using the country for these things. I don't believe the people in Germany are less racist than the American people. I believe that the American capitalism has captured our entire government through the two-party system, and that we actually, the people here, have very little chance, short of revolution, to change things, and they can, and therefore we're being, I won't say reduced because it's very honorable, but moral protest to, like, to say, you know, I'm less racist than you guys who aren't noticing this problem, it's not going to take on the power that has captured the United States, which was born in racism, but so was all of Europe. So was all of Europe. You know, and who has been more racist than the Germans in history? I mean, it is not just the moral issue that we are the worst people of the whole world. It's we have we do not have a democracy anymore. It's a lie that we actually have total a democracy. How can you have 100 congressmen voting for this and that? Senators and all again and again. You know, the war on terror. I can't remember Barbara Lee opposed the concept, but basically it said the U.S. president can go anywhere in the world and kill anyone. And how, you know, so, and also the thing against Russia, they're threatening Russia now with, you know, nuclear war. And you know, the Russians are white for the most part. I think it's a very key fundamental issue, and I think it is a reason that people who drone and work here and all, but I do also, and I don't know if American people would have responded as the Germans did with the whole immigrants, but I think if our leadership was saying we need to take care of these people here in this country, people were saying that, the American people are just as kind and open-hearted as people in other parts of the world that are living, of course, in still racist structures and classist structures.
Well, except for the 30% or so that have been systematically organized for the last decades into a really fascist movement.
Well, if you look at the undercutting of democracy in the United States, it starts and has always been within that group of people who will exclude black voters. Mm-hmm. And this is a systematic assault that has been going on forever. And so when you say, oh, our democracy is going down the drain, well, it's going down the drain because these voters have been prevented. And that's the beginning of it. So, but I don't want to get into like who's you know, less or more racist. What I'm speaking of really is if you look at the American left in the United States. These wars are the third rail of politics for the left. Nobody wants to touch it. And I believe myself did it because it has to do with race. Now, I might be totally wrong, but that's my opinion. Because when you look into why are people afraid of those people in other countries, and what's real and what's made up, why are they afraid of black people in the United States? What's real and what's made up? You have huge numbers of people in prison, black, in the United States, armies of black men in prison because people are afraid of them for no reason, except that's convenient to make
because
people afraid
of them. Because
the
system is afraid of them.
Well, I'm just talking about the leadership finds it convenient to pit people against one another, and black people have always been used to frighten white people to do certain things. And I think with Germany, it's a very unusual, peculiar situation because the German conscience have been wakened up by a huge slaughter of millions of people on racial terms. So I'm not speaking today of Germany or I don't know anything about German politics. I'm speaking about what goes on the left here in the United States, where you cannot get peace, any war on the agenda of almost any group that I've spoken to or been part of, other than folks who are interested in the drone warfare.
Do you remember quickly? It's not just Germany. This resolution, European Parliament resolution that I read to you guys, this was supported across Europe by more than 500 parliamentarians against 49. So this means it was supported throughout Europe, and not just supported by the left and the Greens, but in fact supported by all of the parties. So why is the U.S. so different? Not only, I don't know if it's the racism. I think there's a lot of racism in France and Germany and in all of these countries. But I feel that they somehow still have much more respect for international law and for democratic principles in some way, and they are less captured. Their whole electoral system is much less captured by financial capital, by the weapons industry. I mean, the definitions of fascism, I used to study it a long time ago, it might not be, but is the most vicious part of finance capital, you know, whatever. And I think that it's the capitalism, to be honest, that's driving this, and more, but it's supported, of course, and using all the racism in the society, but the racism indigenous in the society is not more than in other countries. How can we have the rise of Le Pen otherwise?
Carol and then Kat.
I do you remember the 2003 invasion, the bombings that were being shown on all the networks?
Yeah.
Do you remember the marches then? New York City, the first march in New York City was had to be 500,000 people.
Yeah.
And then the one right in D.C., remember that? That was over 1 million people.
Most of us were there.
So what happened? You know, I mean, everybody said, oh, well, Obama. People became complacent because we had a black president. But it can't be that. All of those people who came out then cannot have been fooled by him. That's what I don't get, is why this group is gigantic, because this is the biggest issue in the world, right?
It has something to do with the U.S. being so far to date an unchallenged superpower. And that is what's coming apart. That's Trump coming in. Some feel in the ruling class their last chance to really establish and to hold on to power.
But I was thinking about us. Where did we go? It has an effect.
Well, we had millions of people in the street, and we denied the U.S. from having the coalition it wanted, you know, to pursue the Iraq war, but we didn't stop it. And really, the numbers, 3 days after the invasion, there was 200,000 people marching down 6th Avenue in New York City, and we never had those numbers again.
But this is worldwide, and this was started out of Cairo, don't forget. It was started by the Cairo social thing, which I went to twice before. And in Berlin, we also had 500,000. And, you know, our peace movement is also, you know, in comparison with then, very, very little.
What do you think then? The response of citizens, or the lack of the passive?
I feel actually the fact that we had the biggest demonstration that had ever been in the history of the world, worldwide, to try to stop the Iraq war, and they still went ahead. The U.S. still went ahead. The U.S. gives the signal, you know, you can't do anything. And we don't care what your morality is, and we don't care whatever. And they tell the whole world this. And people in other countries in Europe are, in a way, terrified of the U.S. Now they're trying to get their courage together to say, well, you know, this is going too far, and we want a little bit. But, you know, it's very, I think it's the fact that we don't have a democratic system anymore. And actually, not only here do people think it, all around the world. They're even left people, they're always saying, oh, when are you going to get the next good president? Also, they're very shocked about Trump. And I agree with you that he's a fascist, and then it turned out he's quite a bit worse than Hillary would have been in this issue. But the fact is that they are, in Germany, many left people were any demonstrations against Trump, because they were hoping that, you know, he would make peace with Russia. You know, everyone feels helpless around the entire world against whoever is the U.S. president. That's the fact.
Well, I think, I'd like to answer. I think when the war was going to start, I think there was a prospect in the way Bush was behaving and his vice president, that this was going to be a huge slaughter.
Yeah.
And that would involve a slaughter of Americans as well. And at any one time, they might not have had more than 100,000 troops there. But over the course of like the first, you know, 7 years, there were millions of troops who processed through there. And many, many came home really damaged people. And so in many communities, that was in keen evidence. That, and so when, you know, Obama came in, Bush went out, and Obama said, we don't want to send more troops there. That would, to me, that was because people here felt, oh, we don't want to have any more suicides and like that. But I think that where Obama and the military went was to say, we're using drones now. And if that spares our troops, the fact that it's slaughtering these other people, that's where, to me, the racism comes in. Okay, well, it's slaughtering those other people.
Yeah. But all the countries want it for that reason. Germany doesn't want to send anyone to war, but they want to be involved in the wars.
Yeah, well, you see, that's the thing. Where do they want to be involved with war, and to what end? No one has attacked, Afghan people have not attacked Germany, yet the Germans want these drones to be in Afghanistan. Afghanistan's hugely rich in minerals. Down the road, people are looking toward exploiting those things. And so, if the fact that there are people, you know, there who are primitives makes it, okay, well, they have to deal with the primitives. How do we do it? We just zap them from the air, like this air war, which when history looks back on this air war that's going on right now and the full dimensions of it are known, people are going to be astounded. They're not going to believe what we perpetrated against people.
You know, I'll just say very quickly, the big mistake that was made that killed the peace movement was when Obama came in, and I loved Obama, but he really made some terrible mistakes. He should have prosecuted Bush like
exactly.
Man.
Yeah.
He was a war criminal. He got us into that war with complete lies. All those American soldiers are suffering terribly then, and they're still suffering terribly now from that damn war, and it was built on lies, and he could have been put in jail for the rest of his life if it had been done right, and they just decided to drop it. And that took the steam out of all the anti-war protests, because when people saw that he had millions of people in the street and they can still go and bomb the country, and then nothing happens to people that started that war based absolutely on lies, and everybody knew it was lies. There was no secret about that.
Maybe that's the role of the Democrats.
Isn't the whole, mass incarceration is the same facade as the war? I mean, like this, the system, this country creates the conditions of, you know, poverty or lack of opportunity or whatever that make people criminals, you know, so that it can then turn around and make whatever excuse to call you a criminal and put you in jail. So, and it's like, you know, to kind of refer to what Carol was saying, that there's so many people that work to keep that system going that they're not going to be out sort of protesting against it, because so much of their energy actually goes into keeping it going.
Co-optation.
You know?
Judy, did you want to say something?
Oh, Nick triggered something when he said when people look back, they're going to be so horrified. And I was thinking about the way I felt when I was like, I don't know, 19 or 20 years old, and I read the book about the Native Americans, you know, I left my heart at Wounded Knee. Mm-hmm. It was like, it had never occurred to me, you know, and you would think, even now, you know, but the U.S. is, of course, still ascendant in its power to the degree that people can't speak what they really think. But, you know, that was a genocide, you know, a deliberate and, perpetrated genocide. And, or what the great UK did, or whatever it was called at the time, what England did on the partition of Pakistan and India, setting the Muslims against the Hindus. And to this day, keeping it going at some level, and the United States is now the lead player. And I just think that this is really a time when people are frustrated. It's beyond people's grasp. It's not even that people look in horror. It's beyond their grasp. It's so horrific that they choose not to look at it because they don't feel empowered to address it. And during the Iraq War, we actually felt optimism I mean, not optimism about the war, but optimism that we could stop it.
Yeah.
And when we saw that, you know, the guy who was going to stop it, A, didn't, and that he, no one was persecuted or prosecuted, and that we went immediately within, you know, I mean, 2011, we were wiping Libya off the face of the earth. You know, immediately went on, only now with humanitarian reasons for doing it, for destroying a country and taking all the humanitarian benefits away from the people there. You know, I think people, they just can't wrap their minds around it, and they have financial problems, the kids can't go to college anymore. The, you know, I think it's just unbelievably, it's like a pressure cooker for people, and that at that point they turn inward and start looking at, you know, how do I survive tomorrow, and they forget it, but it's not smart, but I mean, it's not certainly addressing any root problems, but it's human nature.
Yeah. We're going to have some closing comments from the panel.
Well, mine wasn't a closing, well, this is kind of a closing comment. I didn't see you come in, Judy.
Oh, sorry, I was late.
But people should know that Judy Bello is also one of the key players in Upstate Drone Action. And in fact, if you go to www.upstatedroneaction.org, you'll be going to Judy's creation. So to learn more about our campaign, that's the place to go and the person to talk to. And I should have been thinking about closing comments. Maybe I'll yield my time.
I mean, we are the people that are trying to put this in place. That's the mission of what we're working on, right? And all sorts of visual, political, moral, historical ways.
Well, my comment would be to realize that in fact there are unequal degrees of oppression in different countries, even in the West, and that therefore in this drone work and what you're doing here, with the moral witness and all of that, it's really important to try to get that, even if the U.S. media is not listening or whatever, to try to create items that could be circulated, and you know, I don't know what the blowback would be if you know, if we ever did get, for example, the German government to say, okay, we're closing down your drone operation in Ramstein or whatever, or we're not taking this weapon, it's too horrible. We've seen what's, instead of saying we're not going to do what the Americans, that's the first thing they say, we're not going to use it like the Americans, it's just going to be troop support, that's what they say. But we, you know, that they would realize it's also this, what the weapon's designed for. I mean, I think it's, I mean, that just with regard to this weapon. But I also think it's very important in the U.S. peace movement to, the U.S. peace movement is observed as a little bit imperialist sometimes when they come to Europe, because there's a tendency to think it's just all about the U.S. Europeans are concerned that their countries will militarize. Germans are very worried that their elites will have the most horrible military, even worse than the U.S. because of the history of Germany. And there are some neo-fascists and neo-Nazis in the German military. There's a whole, you know, it attracts those type of people, and this is being investigated. And so you have to be aware that it is more multi. The U.S. appears all powerful, but these other countries, you know, have their own things. I mean, and so it's good to try to always fight here. This is the enemy here, but still keep an awareness that others are fighting their ruling classes in their countries primarily.
You know. I do, for anybody who's not familiar or newly interested, I want to send people to those websites, and we also have some DVDs of important videos up here that are given to World Can't Wait for free. One is a short feature called Unmanned that is really instructive about the moral choices that drone pilots have to make. And the other one is Collateral Murder. We're celebrating the release of Chelsea Manning from prison, which was unexpected and one good thing that happened under Obama. And this is really what she went to prison for, in my opinion, having sat through the trial, is the release of this footage.
I have one closing comment. Has everybody here seen the movie I Am Not Your Negro? I would say that it's very important and to encourage other people to see that.
So thanks everyone for coming, and this will be up on worldcantwait.net, and we'll share it with the panelists and share materials that they have with you as well. There's going to be an ongoing process here of trying to grapple with some of these questions. Upstate Drone Coalition's not giving up. World Can't Wait's not giving up. ELSA's not.
No,
I'm not just
Elsa. No, I know, but you're. I'm the internet, the one that communicates between them, but it seems that way here. But there's a huge movement, of course, yeah. But I wanted to offer my little film that I was looking for the kind of where it's in, but I do have it here, which also, just to take if you'd like, it's called We Were Soldiers in the War on Terror. It's 23 minutes of testimony in the Iraq War veterans. And it's good for schools. In this case, I happened to grab what I had. It has German subtitles, but they're talking in English. So if you want a souvenir of our international exchange here, I'll put some of those up. What? It's just English, but what I brought